To all the fathers, wishing you a very happy Father's Day. Today, all around the world, children will be celebrating their fathers, and let us also celebrate our fathers in our lives. Not only today, but every day, not only our fathers, but also our dear mothers. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 2, Paul quotes an Old Testament scripture. In fact, right from the Ten Commandments, he is writing in this epistle, and it goes like this. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise. Amen. And what is the promise? I'm paraphrasing it. It will be a blessed life and a long life on earth, which is a wonderful promise to experience. But I also believe it is a wonderful commandment to follow and to obey. Why? When we honor our parents, okay, what we are doing is we are honoring our God in our life. Now, this commandment is not only for the little toddlers or the kids in the junior church or Sunday school, but it is applicable for all the age group, whether if someone is at the age 10 or 20 or 30, 40, 50, 60, it is applicable for all of us. Whether our parents are with us or not, we should always honor them in our hearts and through our actions. Amen. By doing that, what we are doing is we are honoring God and glorifying God, and in that we will experience the goodness of God over our lives. This morning I want to share from John chapter 1 verse 17, and I'm going to expound this scripture through another story from John chapter 8. So let me quote this scripture, John chapter 1 verse 17. The law was given through Moses, But the grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. So let me explain this scripture through another story. I believe even as we dwell upon this story, God will speak to us and minister to us through this story. Now, Jesus had a busy day. I'm quoting this story from John chapter 8. I sincerely request you read the scriptures. I personally believe God will speak to each and every one beyond what I am sharing through this message. Now, Jesus had a very busy day. When everybody went back to their house, after the busy day, what did Jesus do? He went to the Mount Olives to pray. Amen. He went to the Mount of Olives to pray. So it's a very interesting thing. You know, when he was tired, probably he could have gone home and eaten a good meal and slept, but Jesus went up to the Mount of Olives and he was spending time with the Father. Probably the Father would have asked Jesus, "Son, tonight come with me, I want to show you something. Son, tonight come with me, I want to, I want to refresh you. Son, tonight come with me, I want to speak to you. Son, tonight come with me, I want to be with you." The Father would have spoken something which would have made Jesus to seek the Father, to spend time with him, and probably it was Jesus' desire. "No, I'm tired, Father, I want to spend time with you." "Jesus, I want to know you, Father. I'm tired, I don't know what holds for tomorrow, but I want to hear from you so that you can prepare me. Or I just want to be with you." You know, it was mutual relationship, love relationship between the Son and the Father. And he was spending time with the Father on the Mount of Olives. On the next morning, early morning, he comes to the temple. When he came to the temple, Bible says people recognized him and they came to him to learn from him, and Jesus was teaching the people what he was learning from the Father. Now, during that time, the scribes and the Pharisees, they brought a woman who was caught in the very act of adultery, so that they would bring to Jesus to trap Jesus. And they were quoting the scripture to Jesus, saying that, you know, according to the Moses, according to the law, such a person should be stoned to death, but you tell us what to do. It was like a trap on Jesus by bringing this woman to defame Jesus or demoralize Jesus or to condemn Jesus or something, so that Jesus would not do ministry, or Jesus would be, you know, left from this city, something they wanted to do against Jesus. But in the wisdom of God, you know, probably what he would have learned on the Mount of Olives, he began to practice with the scribes and the Pharisees. What he was doing, he was keeping quiet and beginning to write on the floor. As he was doing that, probably, you know, all the mob mentality, people who were very furious and were angry, they were little frustrated by Jesus' action and they were wondering what Jesus is doing. And Jesus was drawing their attention to him, and then finally Jesus spoke to them, "The one who has not committed sin, let him be the first person, pick up a stone and throw it at her." When everyone heard this statement, everyone realized that all of us are sinners. We all have sinned against God, and you know, we have done something wrong, and we are not the right person to do this. We are not the right person to condemn this lady. And one by one, everyone left the scene, beginning with the older person and to the last, the younger person. Now, only Jesus and this lady was left alone. Only Jesus and the lady was left alone over here. Jesus asked, "Where are all these people who came to condemn you?" She said, "Nobody is here, Lord. Everybody is gone back." And Jesus said something very interesting. Neither I condemn you. Now, if one person who was capable enough to throw a stone on this lady, or if one person who had the authority to throw a stone on this lady, it was Jesus, because he was the righteous man, he fulfilled the law, you know, he was a sinless person, he could have easily done that, but instead of throwing the stone, he was offering the grace of God to this lady. He was offering the grace of God, saying that I condemn you, no, I'm not here to condemn you. By doing that, what he is doing, by saying that what he is doing, he is offering the grace of God to this lady. Now, if only grace was given to her, probably, you know, she would have felt nice about it. She would have thought, okay, I am free. I am, you know, not in a place to die right now. If she was a shameless woman, she would have gone back, continued her old profession. If she was a professional woman who would do all these nasty things, she would have gone back to do the same thing. Or else, if she would have felt guilt and shame, okay, she would have gone back and committed suicide. Okay, but what was Jesus doing? While she was going, Jesus said, "Sin no more. Live your life of sin and sin no more." That truth, when Jesus spoke to this lady, empowered her to live righteously, to live without sin, without shame and guilt in her life. The grace of God made her free. The truth of God made her strong. The grace of God empowered to receive the truth in her life. The grace of God empowered to live victoriously by the truth she experienced from Jesus. The truth of God removed the lies that she was thinking about herself, that she was worthless, that she had to live a life like this, or that she will go and commit suicide. The fallen mindset, the condemning mindset, was demolished when Jesus spoke the truth, "Sin no more." That means she believed she can live a life without sin. She believed she can live a clean life. She believed she is a new person. So that empowered her to live a life of freedom, a life as a new person. This is what happens when we experience grace and truth. Now, truth here is not to condemn or punish us, but the truth of God here is to restore us to the image of God, is to make us whole, is to clean us, is to heal us, so that by the grace of God, in the truth of God's word, we are experiencing the wholesome life. We are experiencing not only freedom, but also strength and direction to live by. We get the right mindset. The truth of God gives us the right thinking. When we have the right thinking, our behavior will be, our actions will be right actions. Amen. So that is what Jesus has done to this lady, which I believe he wants to do to us even now. If we are caught in some kind of a trouble, or if you have some kind of a fallen mindset, if you are not believing the right thing, this morning I believe, even as I'm sharing this message, believe for the grace of God over your life, which is true. It is not because I am preaching this message you are experiencing the grace of God. It is because of the love of God over your life, you will experience the grace of God. And because of what Jesus has done for us, we all will experience the grace of God over our life. And even as I'm speaking this thing, I pray that you will also experience the truth of God about you. The truth of God is not to condemn us or to punish us, but to restore us, to heal us back to the image of God, so that you and I have the right belief and we will have the right living. Amen. Right belief so that we can have the right living. So that is how Jesus will help us this morning or today in our life. So let us believe the grace of God and the truth of God to work right now. Amen. Let us believe for the grace of God and the truth of God to work right now. I don't know what situation that we may be in. We may be in a difficult situation. Maybe we may be in an impossible situation. We would have cried a lot. But today, let us believe for freedom. Freedom from every bondage. Freedom from every sin. Freedom from everything which is holding us not to move forward. Let us break free and let us live free in the grace of God and in the truth of God.